Hello and welcome to IVCC. My name is Justin Davies. I'm an interventional cardiologist at Imperial College London, and it's my pleasure to be here today at Hammersmith Hospital and to be joined by colleagues David Kandzari and Iqbal Malik to do a very interesting and challenging case of triple vessel disease, which we're going to do as part of the Syntex 2 study. I'd like to welcome my colleague Dr. Rasha Alami here, who's going to talk us through the case, and then we'll discuss it between ourselves.
Thanks very much, Justin. So again, welcome to Hammersmith Hospital. This is an elective case that we have for you today. A 68-year-old gentleman who's hypercholesterolemic, hypertensive and type 2 diabetic. He's presented to us 2 months ago with exertional chest tightness on moderate exertion and was said to have CCS class 2 symptoms. He went on to have an exercise tolerance test, at which point he developed chest pain and also significant ST depression at stage 2. He's known to have a normal creatinine and normal LV function, and we scored him for his Syntex 1 score at 23, and Syntex 2 came out with PCI at 47 and CABG at 36. Now, so you can see once again that he has this moderate mid-vessel lesion within the circumflex artery, and also a long segment of proximal to mid-LAD disease. And once again, you can see the severe lesion in his first diagonal, although that's a relatively small vessel, probably about 2 millimeters diameter. And what we can see from the left coronary pictures is also the PDA backfilling from the left coronary system. And if we go on to have a look at the right coronary images, we can see that there's a moderate to severe mid-vessel right lesion, and also the PDA appears occluded. Now, on these images, the PDA looks to be a relatively small vessel, but we will assess this further and see whether we decide to intervene on this vessel. So what we decided, following entering in all his details into the Syntex 2 scoring system, was that he came out with clinical equipoise for CABG versus PCI, and therefore we could enter him into the Syntex 2 study. Now, he has now been assessed by the heart team, who deemed that he was eligible for PCI, and what we plan to do is perform IFR in the right coronary artery, the circumflex and the LAD, and using the hybrid approach we will go on to perform FFR in if we find that the IFR is anywhere between 0.86 and 0.93, and for positive physiological lesions we'll go on to implant synergy stents and optimize those stents using IVUS guidance modified by the music criteria, and in any lesions obviously that are negative physiologically we'll leave those alone. He'll have optimum medical therapy, and we've started him on atorvastatin 80 milligrams and also obviously dual antiplatelet therapy for a year. These are our live case operators, Dr. Justin Davies, Dr. Iqbal Malik and Dr. David Kandzari, and we'll go on now to review the images and see where we are today. Thank you very much.
So I'm excited about this just because these are a lot of new applications of technologies we've been using in our practice, but with a little bit of twist, like with co-registration and the IFR as well. And just having reviewed the angiograms, as Rasha did as well, we were going to start with the right coronary artery, perform the IFR, and make our decisions on whether to treat that, and then move to the left coronary system.
Great. So we've got the pressure wire open. I'm not sure if Iqbal wants to talk us through how we set this up in, as a standard technique.
Okay, so if we can focus on the table. Right, so this is pretty much as it comes out of the packet. So I flushed this once already, just because if you wait a minute or two, the temperature sort of sorts itself out. But there's a 1-2-3 approach. You may not be able to see it on the plastic packet, but number one is a syringe with flush written on it. So if you can read, you can follow the instructions. So we will flush. I can read. And so once we've done that, then we'll just lay it flat and open number two. The tab has number two written on it. And so we'll open the tab, and without getting things too wet, and hopefully without getting too much blood on it, we'll hand the cable over, and that's going to plug in. And then if we focus on the screen, the physiology screen, you can see that in the corner it says waiting to zero. And so this is a moment for us to do absolutely nothing while we wait for the machine to settle down. It'll take probably about 15 seconds max, so we'll just wait that time. And as soon as it says wait, the waiting time is done, it says ready. And then we'll be ready to go. We'll focus back on the table. Yeah, it's ready to go. So if we focus back on the table, step number three is just to remove everything from the packet. And so this is where I'll let David take over. I'll hold the coil.
So David, these wires we've got come with a straight tip, and you usually put a small bend on the pressure wire?
I do. I put a small bend on the pressure wire here, and I'm just going to use the wire introducer to do that, but just being very gentle with it. This is a fairly, we hope, straightforward lesion here, and the anatomy is not too challenging. So I'm just going to put a standard J-tip bend on the guide wire. And I think we're ready to insert then,
yep,
correct?
Yeah. So we've pre-heparinized. He's had 70 units per kilogram. We've just checked an ACT. We'll aim to keep it between 250 and 300. And we're pretty much set, ready to go. I don't know, while David's sort of getting the wire in, we could look at the pressure screen.
There we go.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Justin, we were just talking before you joined us about when we want to pull back the guiding catheter to do our calibration and when we feel it's acceptable to do it. I thought, well, you brought up a good point about the dichrotic notch and how that's reassuring. But what are your thoughts on this, too?
I think you're 100% right. I think it's very easy a lot of the time just to focus in on the actual the value, so to try and get a ratio of one, and people think that's satisfactory. But I think, as you're suggesting here, there's a lot more detail which we should be looking for to ensure that we don't have a damped pressure wave signal. So if you do, you can seriously underinterpret the severity of the lesion, and then you can lead to the wrong treatment for patients. So I think in this case, we can see on the screen that there's a very nice dichrotic notch, and that's evident in both the wire and the aortic signal. And we haven't yet normalized this signal. And you can see that already the two curves are almost over. Yeah.
So, Justin, you've made that point before, that even if it looks like the PDPA is 1 and the curves are almost identical, especially for IFR, I think it's very, very important not to miss this next step, which is to normalize, because even a slight time shift of 15, 20 milliseconds could affect the IFR reading because of that very key diastolic period. So, Rasha, should we go ahead and sort of normalize?
I think, in short, it probably means that there's probably never an instance where you don't want to normalize then, right?
Totally right. Yeah. Absolutely right. Even if it's the wire's been out and you come back in and the ratio is 1, it takes 5 seconds and you've got confidence. Yeah.
Rasha, you're ready for me to advance then?
Yeah.
So I'm just going to reinsert the needle introducer just for the component of advancing the wire. And am I in the main channel? There we go.
Yeah, there you go.
I was finding every little branch there for a bit. Any preferences on how far down we should go once we're past the lesion?
I think typically we want to be 2 diameters width beyond the stenosis, because after that distance, at least that distance, then you're in an area where the flow would be normal once again. So, I mean,
that seems so.
You're really sufficient there.
And let me just withdraw this needle introducer.
Great. Okay, so it just confirms that we're very distal, because, of course, the one thing we can't see on our physiology screen is exactly where that wire is. So we've now got a record of it. And Justin, how long do you wait after a contrast injection before you take a measurement?
So if you're giving contrast, you typically want to wait 10, 15 seconds, and things normalize. I think the only exception to that is if you have a very critical lesion where even the wire sometimes could make the territory ischemic beyond it. And you'll find often if you give contrast or you give adenosine, you can have ischemia which prolonged periods thereafter. So, just in almost all cases, it's 15, 20 seconds. Yeah.
Now, if we look on the physiology screen, this sometimes happens, doesn't it? There's a little shatter on the wire. And I don't know about you, David, but I tend to just pull the wire back a fraction. Maybe it's just a tiny bit too distal, and then that shatter sort of disappears. It's almost settling down by itself, isn't
it?
That's fine.
You brought up a good point, though. Once we had initially advanced it, we saw a little bit more. Now it seems to have settled down a bit. You agree?
Okay.
Let's go ahead, Rasha. So 0.98, that's a very, very negative value here. And we can measure again, Rasha. And
so, Justin, being for myself relatively new to IFR, we were letting the software do its calculation. We haven't given any adenosine, which is quite nice and cost savings from my perspective. Is there a need to repeat the IFR measurements? Is it fairly reproducible, or is just one time good enough?
I think you only have to make the measurement once. Of course, it only takes 4 or 5 seconds to make the measurement again. And I think, as you've seen here, there's very good reproducibility, which I think all the studies have shown. I think we largely do it now just probably out of habit more than anything else. But you can see we've got good consistency of the values in this case.
Well, I have to say that I actually thought this would have been a significant lesion hemodynamically, and I think the two of you thought otherwise, so you have much more experience with it than I do, but I'm impressed with it.
So David, on the way back here, is it, can we just do a drift check just to make sure we've had no significant drift?
Tell me when you're ready, Rasha.
We'll just place it.
We'll do it under fluoro?
Yeah. And we'll just hold at the top there, and we'll take a reading there. That's great.
So again, we routinely just record a few beats just so we can document in our data set that we've got normalization documented as well. And that obviously, in this case, has been no drift at all.
Perfect.
Yeah.
That was a light one with contrast, but I think that'll suffice.
Okay, so we're going to change over to a guide catheter for the other side. David, what's your preferred guide for the left?
I'd like to use an extra backup catheter, either an EBU or an XB catheter.
Yeah, so we've got EBU 3.5 or 4?
3.5, sure.
3.5, okay, so we'll take an EBU 3.5.
So we finished off on the right coronary artery, and now David's taken an EBU 3.5 for the left system. And he's positioned that, and we're going to administer 300 micrograms of intracoronary nitrates just before we take our acquisition pictures to try and get the maximum diameter of the vessels possible.
Hold that, that's good. Okay.
Want to take a picture of that?
Mm-hmm.
Ready?
Okay, so I think we got it. And again, what do you think about that, David? You've seen the circumflex now with nitrates given and a guide catheter. Let's ask that question. Is that going to be a significant lesion or a not significant lesion when we do a pressure wire assessment?
I think it's definitely worth assessing to begin with. And secondly, based on my previous experience here of our last case, I'm going to say it's probably not significant. But I would say this, is that the lesion length is long. So therefore, the resistance in flow may be more than what I appreciate.
Mm.
Your thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's going to be negative. And, you know, this is one of the powers of being in this study, in that a lot of people would have looked at this angiogram, seen three-vessel coronary disease, referred for bypass surgery. Mm-hmm. He's a diabetic, after all. We've already gone down to two-vessel disease, and this may get to single-vessel disease. So I'm going to plump for negative. Justin?
Well, I think David's right. It's definitely a vessel worth assessing. It's long. And perhaps some of the PDA, there's a small branch of the PDA which is occluded, maybe is coming and being supplied by collaterals from this territory as well. So I think an assessment is wise, and we'll see what that shows. Mm-hmm. It's always difficult to guess these lesions there.
Justin, as I've shared with you, though, I think this is the smart PCI approach here, though, because you know, we're not only avoiding unnecessarily treating vessels, whether by surgery or by percutaneous revascularization. But if we think about it, especially from a PCI perspective, for every lesion we treat, we have a restenosis risk, and we're reducing the risk of our efficacy failures as well.
Mm-hmm.
I did want to bring up the issue when we got to the LAD, but I think you've already brought it up as a good point now about collateralization and vessels that are donor vessels and FFR measurements. In this instance, I think there might be some epicardial collateral that you mentioned as well, but principally I think it's from the septals. But whether it's the LAD or the circumflex, Justin, let me ask you this, is that how much of a difference do you really see? Conceptually, we do a lot of CTOs at our institution. We see intermediate disease in a donor vessel. We oftentimes think that perhaps the FFR would be abnormal, but after we recanalize the CTO, that the FFR would go above the ischemic threshold. How often do you really see that in clinical play, in practice?
Well, I think it certainly happens, and it certainly happens when you've got an intermediate lesion with a supplying bicollaterals, a more severe lesion. And the interesting thing, I think, from a physiological perspective, is this is where you may well see differences between these different techniques we use. Early work has shown that where FFR perhaps benefits is it can show you, if you measure in one vessel, the effects of the whole myocardium. Now, that's helpful if you want to know total kind of myocardial ischemia and the burden of that. But less helpful if you've got multiple lesions and you want to know which is contributing the most. And that's where I think some of these resting values such as IFR will help, because without recruiting all those other territories and just simply looking at the epicardial effects on of a given stenosis you're interrogating, you have a much more lesion-specific measure. So I think that the combination of the two gives you different bits of information.
I think that's going to be especially relevant in syntax too, when you've got patients with multivessel disease and the frequency of chronic total occlusion. So it'll be an interesting aspect of the study.
Definitely will.
Okay, so shall we take a picture of the left-hand descending artery? So can you go cranial? So PA cranial with about 10 of right. It's a little overlapped, isn't it? So can we try and go to more of an REO and more cranial just to open that out? So what do you think of that PDA, David? Is that something that you'd ordinarily sort of chase up, or would you leave to another session?
I think that, as we were discussing earlier, first of all, you already get the idea here that we've got disease in the diagonal branch, which we'll also talk about, as well as the mid-LAD. And then, to your point, the collateralization to the distal PDA. Given the fact that we're taking on assessment of the circumflex, the right coronary artery, and the LAD here, my guess is that, or my approach would be to leave this alone, treat this patient medically, and only if this patient still had persistent refractory angina after we treat what we intend to at least assess and potentially treat, would I think about doing the PDA itself. Mm. But your points about complete revascularization, I think, that's a great picture.
That is a good picture.
Are well taken here, because I do believe that completeness of revascularization is a significant determinant of outcome here. In this case, when I think of complete revascularization, though, I'm thinking about significant territories here, and this looks like a small territory for the PDA.
That's a very important distinction there between perhaps what people used to think of complete revascularization, chasing stents into very small vessels, from perhaps the, as you say, the smart PCI approach that we're starting to adopt in these studies now.
So my thought was that we would initially perhaps assess the circumflex, and then we may take on more greater challenges with the LAD. Justin, let me ask you, in your practice too, we've zeroed the wire from the outset. Do we calibrate again? Or do we normalize again?
I would always normalize again,
Yeah.
Always normalize. There may have been a small amount of pressure drift. Also, the temporal alignment sometimes can change due to the feedbacks, pathways between the hemosystem and the console. So always renormalize.
So I, thinking the same, had stopped once we exited the guiding catheter here, and we still have a good tracing, but still a need to normalize.
Yeah.
And Rasha, you've normalized, so we're good to go. All right, perfect. Just going to grab our torquer again.
David, I'm sure that you've experienced a whole range of pressure-wise over the years.
We have. I think, just as you say, well, we're more closely approximating standard workhorse wires with these technologies, too. To that point, today I seem to want to find every little side branch with the wires, too. Do you have any particular concerns about leaving the wire in a smaller side branch when you're doing FFR? Do you always try to land the wire in the largest epicardial segment downstream?
With regards to the sensor position or the tip?
Both.
So the sensor, I definitely want to try and have it free from the wall, because I think, as we saw early, you can occasionally get little spikes in the distal wire pressure signal if the sensor is touching the wall, and that moves in phase with the cycle. With regards to the parking the tip into a little branch, I think that's probably okay, as long as you're not pushing it on too much and it's just resting in there. What about yourselves.
So, I mean, I would say that you found a great position here. Yeah. It's in the main vessel. And the advantage of that is that then when that lesion becomes significant, then you can carry on and do your whole angioplasty. Whereas if you're taking the pressure measurement, it's in a small side branch, and it turns out to be positive, then you have to reposition it. So spending that extra moment that you did getting into the proper distal vessel, I think, is always worthwhile.
For the same reasons, I have the same practice as you. Yeah. Mm.
Okay, so David's found a fantastic position here with the wire, and we're ready to go ahead and make an IFR measurement.
All set.
Please do.
And to your point, the wire signal is very stable there as well.
So there we go, David. We've got a value here of 0.96, and we know that in the protocol for the Syntex 2 study, that's above the range where we would repeat the measurement.
Great.
So
okay,
this time I think consistent maybe with our preconceptions.
So Dave, you've moved the wire into the LAD, and now we're going to normalize again.
All set to normalize. Yes.
Okay.
Perfect. So if we can, perhaps we'll go back to the aureocranial view. And probably be worthwhile for us to just take another look at the angiogram again, as if we can. I was noticing that
play the angio.
If we were to do IVUS, for instance, I'm sure that that LAD is diseased proximally all the way back to its origin. And I think here a pullback will be interesting as well with the IFR.
So let's play that shot. That's our roadmap shot of the aureocranial.
That's nice, yeah.
And not only is there disease in the proximal segment of the diagonal, but the ostium of the diagonal is diseased as well. So what my approach would be is to first test the LAD itself. And if you both agree, we'll advance on down to the distal part of the LAD.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Sufficient there. So this is an example, just as we were talking about, the tip it goes into a small side branch, but certainly the pressure sensor is in the main channel, and I'm going to free up the tip altogether here if I can. There we go.
So we're pretty good there. Should we take a quick picture of that?
Sure. All set?
Mm-hmm. Great.
And I'm just going to pull back again the introducer wire needle, tighten down, just check my position again. And now we've seen a change already in the waveform.
Yeah, so you can see there's a clear separation of the aortic and distal wire pressures. And you can see, we're just waiting a second here, after the administration of contrast, things look to have stabilized. On this machine, you'll see an IFR reading, which is both gives us the PDPA and the IFR on a live beat-by-beat basis. So this is a prototype machine, which is only just starting to be rolled out commercially. We've had it just to test this live IFR and also to use it for the IFR pullback, which of course is necessary. And here you can see that there's a difference here between the resting whole cycle and the IFR values, and things look to have stabilized now quite nicely. So what I suggest we do is make a static measurement here, David.
Okay.
And we'll get a recording, so we can go ahead and do that, and then we'll move ahead and do a pullback.
Perfect.
Okay. So that's a very significant IFR result, which perhaps fits with what you saw angiographically. Of course, we've seen angiographically significant disease in the other vessels.
Yeah, we've already taken three-vessel disease and turned it into single-vessel disease.
Okay. So we'll go ahead and make an IFR pullback recording now.
So I'll wait a couple beats, and then we'll start pulling back. And I'm just gradually, manually pulling back the guidance.
So David, you've done an IFR pullback recording here, and you can see it goes from significant, and it goes fairly flat, the IFR line, and then it jumps up, and it's a little bit flat, and then it's a slow kind of increase until it goes back to zero.
The other issue for this too, Justin, as I was pulling back, is that you have a nice tracing there where you can really see as you're watching in real time the cut point and where your thresholds really change, and we can of course match that up with the angiogram to determine where the differences are. And I think you can appreciate just by the angiogram alone, now knowing where they are, the most critical disease after the diagonal branches, where we have that suppressed flat line with a very significant result. And then there's more moderate disease. There's a small septal perforator here, and there's more moderate disease distal to that but proximal to the diagonal branch, where we still see some values that that are slightly depressed, and then we get back to a very high value here once we're in the proximal LAD itself.
So the question is how we use this information, because it could be that because there's a very sudden jump, that most of the action is in a much shorter segment than we appreciated from the angiogram. And what would your idea be of, you know, looking 3 years into the future and saying, well, on the basis of this physiology, you can say, well, actually, if we treated just, say, 12 millimeters rather than the 30 millimeters we want to treat, that perhaps we have a physiologically normalized vessel and we've saved a lot of stent.
I think this will be an interesting dynamic when we think about the applications of virtual PCI and CT-FFR planning. On the other hand, I say it's going to be an interesting dynamic because we also know that in general, treating from disease to disease segments has been associated with the best outcome here. Mm-hmm. And so I'd be a little bit reluctant to just treat a single focal area amidst a greater disease plaque burden if it appeared that we could successfully treat most of the disease itself. So in short, I think this is where the IVUS will come into play and help guide us as well.
I think the other thing is he's diabetic. And I think for a diabetic patient, I would be wanting to treat the whole segment to try and get the field sorted out, because one of the gaps, I think, between surgery and angioplasty is that we treat less of the field and we don't treat all of the vessels proximal to the bypass. And if you've got disease already, I think you're probably wanting to try and normalize it as much as possible.
You can also see, if you look at the IFR pullback screen, that the tight area of disease effectively would give us an increase in the IFR of about 0.1. So we know there's a publication which will be out very shortly in JACC, which shows how you can use this to very accurately predict functional improvement in lesions when you have tandem disease. Now, interestingly here, you'll see that the improvement we'd expect is about, as I said, 0.1 units, which would take us just into the realms of normality on an IFR scale, but perhaps not treat us as well as we would really like. So we've got this big step up, and then there's more diffuse disease. So you can make both physiological and anatomical arguments probably for stenting more of the vessel.
So the other issue, too, with this case in particular, Justin, is that we were also talking about the diagonal. And we also noticed that there is some modest decrease in the IFR value, probably proximal to that diagonal as well. And we wouldn't get a true assessment of the diagonal lesion, would we, if we just advanced the wire in now, because there'll be some contribution of the LAD too.
You're going to get some contribution, but I think this is an important learning point from a physiology perspective in terms of the difference between rest and hyperemic physiology. So with resting tandem lesion assessment, because rest flow is preserved all the way to about 90%, in the midst of tandem lesions, you can still assess a resting pressure ratio very accurately. The problems really occurs when you try and induce hyperemia. And we all see in the curves where the flow falls off very rapidly, the stenosis becomes more significant from about 50%, which is an advantage if you're measuring flow. But if you're trying to interrogate between different lesions and you expect flow to be constant, it's a huge disadvantage and can lead to massive lesion underestimation. And that's one of the very exciting things about some of these new technologies, such as the IFR pullback, because it enables you to identify a lesion in the midst of culprit tandem lesions and identify which is actually the culprit from a physiological perspective.
And use those same values, those same thresholds for each lesion.
Yes. So what we do is we effectively do exactly what we've done here. We go down to the distal part of the vessel. You confirm that the vessel is significant. Then you do a pullback and you see where the big step-ups are. And then you add to the distal value, in this case 0.81, 0.1 is our step-up. And you say that would make the distal vessel 0.91 or proximal, it may be slightly less. And in that way, you can compute and actually plan in a virtual PCR way how and where most effectively to treat the patient. So,
I suppose in a pragmatic way here, if we decided not to assess that diagonal now, then we're probably going to stent it across it and then have to try and get this pressure wire through the stents. Whereas if we assess it now and fingers crossed it turns out to be non-significant, then we can just stop worrying about it and not have to cross it. So I think we've decided we're going to assess the diagonal.
Yes. So we're going to go down to the diagonal regardless. Okay.
And then,
there you go.
There we go.
Yeah.
I'll park it right there.
So there you go. So we have made the measurement of IFR twice in the diagonal. You can see the patient was moving around and the ECG became very distorted. But we still have two very consistent values here, 0.53 and 0.51, which are clearly very significant.
I think the point's well taken that this would be a diagonal that the surgeons would place a graft into. It supplies a fairly good distribution, and particularly plumped up after the intercoronary nitrates. Mm. So I would say that this would be something I would treat as well.
And we have a wire down. It would be almost rude not to treat it with that wire down.
Well, it raises the issue, though, before, too, that we're going to have the wire that will be a pressure wire that perhaps it may be worthwhile changing to a workhorse wire at some point as well. But the other issue is for us to think about IVUS, right, and co-registration.
Yeah, so I think for the main vessel, I think the co-registration worked really, really well. I think this vessel is probably the size.
I agree. Yeah, no, I meant to get a wire down the LAD and to do co-registration as well. Mm. So I'll take this wire, advance it down the LAD, and we'll plan for IVUS.
So we're going to go to the SyncRx view, as you can see here, and we're going to just go into the co-registration mode. This gives us all the instructions. Essentially, you set up the screen nicely, and we're just going to do an acquisition here with contrast.
Mm-hmm. All set?
Yep.
Great.
Okay, so you can see the computer here has picked the frame, which has got the best contrast with reference to the background there. The vessel appears to be nicely filled with dye. And once it's done that, I'm just going to click on the next button here. And then it's asked me a few things. So can I click on the edge of the catheter, which I'll just do there. And then it asked me to click on the stenosis. So I'm going to click on the stenosis there. And then it asked me to click right at the distal end of the vessel here. And I'm driving all of this through a little joystick, which is just under the drapes here, nothing more than that. So I've done that. And now the next thing I'm going to do is just hit next. And then it's going to effectively say that it's ready for a pullback to begin. So if you just advance the IVUS catheter down to where we want to start, and then we'll start the recording when you're ready.
All right. Catheter tracks quite well past the diseases.
So David, you've advanced the IVUS catheter down to the mid vessel, and it tracked nicely?
Tracked very well. Okay. And we have our markers also to assess length, but I think we're going to get a more accurate assessment here in a few moments.
So what we'll do now is we'll just hit record on the IVUS, and then I'll ask you just to manually withdraw the IVUS catheter as you normally would,
okay.
And then you'd let us know when you finished, and we'll stop the recording. So let's start recording.
All right. Gradually pulling back right now.
We can see a fair amount of atheroma. It's quite a chalky plaque there.
Not a lot of calcification. A little bit of heterogeneous scattered. calcification.
We're getting to the action zone now. You can see that actually that was practically the size of the catheter. And that's a lot of atherometer's burden there. There's a diagonal ostium. Actually, it didn't look too bad to me, but a lot of atheroma above the vessel, as you rightly spotted, David, going up pretty much towards the ostium of the LAD. Look at that. I didn't appreciate that on the angiogram.
And that's super.
Okay, so that's into the left main.
So perfect. Stop record there. And then the next thing I'm going to do is just press finish. And that starts the co-registration process, which takes a couple of seconds. And that's it. So now we've effectively got an angiogram image on the right side of your screen, you can see. IVUS on the left, the longitudinal IVUS view at the bottom. And as I move the cursor along, you get the reference image for where we're looking with regards to the IVUS.
That's very nice. I have to say, as a matter of practicality, there would be instances where I wanted to assess maybe the origin of the LAD, and I might advance the catheter back in, back out, back in. Here, you've got it already in one setting.
You've got it all, yeah. So there's a few things we can do here. We can look to see at these various bifurcation points, at the tightest points of the vessel we were looking at.
Maybe can you show the origin of the diagonal? Because as we flew by, I think we saw the origin of the diagonal branch fairly well. And it didn't look as heavily diseased as one might have thought.
I think we saw that as well.
It's just coming out at about sort of there it is. It's about sort of 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock-ish. And perhaps the way to see it live, so if we place the cursor slightly distally and just press play, then we'll be able to sort of concentrate on that again. And that's the very tight lesion. And again, it's amazing, isn't it? You can see on the angiogram and on the IVUS, the tight bits definitely match. But here comes the interesting part. So that was this sort of septal branch. Yeah. And here's the diagonal origin. And the origin of the diagonal didn't look too diseased to me. There's obviously LAD is hugely diseased, but then the next interesting part is how badly diseased the top end of the LAD actually is, and you can see that atheroma burden is enormous, right up to the origin of it. So if we were going to perform stenting, I think you might be taken with the idea of just stenting up to the ostium of the LAD just to make sure you got normal to normal.
I agree. I think your assessment of the side branch is correct from what we see. I think, of course, our thought leaders in IVUS would say that a flyby view is inadequate, but it is insightful nevertheless there. But what also impresses me is that the IVUS results in the proximal LAD really coincide with what we saw on IFR too. Remember, there was a two-layered step up there, and I think we now understand why. And quite deceiving compared with the angiogram.
So, David, with that information, what's your strategy now for treating this patient?
My thought is, just as you say, the disease length, especially in the setting of diabetes, is going to be much longer than we might have otherwise anticipated, though. I think we stent from the LAD mid segment back to the origin of the LAD itself. And also, just as a quick aside, we have some lessons from IVUS that when we see ostial LAD disease, 90% of the time it's going to extend back to the left main as well. And we do see some albeit mild plaque in the left main segment too. But also, I would be inclined to treat the diagonal branch based on the IFR measurements. And we had talked about whether to treat that focal segment or come back all the way to the origin. I think that if we just end up putting a stent in that focal segment, we might be chasing ourselves a little bit with the origin. My inclination would be to treat the entire disease segment back to the origin of the diagonal, and then treat the LAD as well.
So the problem, of course, would be that it's not a 90-degree takeoff. This is not going to be a T stent. So the safest thing would be then, if you're going to do that, to leave a stent just inside the ostium, and so that leave the triangle of death. Alternatively, you're going to have the stent poking out and then become a slightly more complicated bifurcation strategy. So that was my sort of feeling about just stenting short and assessing physiologically, and if it was fine, then we just keep the bifurcation strategy simple, because it is after a sort of
a vessel on the slightly smaller side. But
we have a lot of options to us, but we're also using a 6-French guiding catheter. But of course, we can talk about culotte technique and different variants of T-stenting and backstop techniques. Mm. One of the techniques that I most commonly use now is the double kiss crush technique. This is one technique that has been associated with a reduction in side branch restenosis in comparison to both mini crush and culotte techniques. It's something that can be done by a 6-French guiding catheter as well.
We've performed the co-registration in the LAD with the IVUS, and now we're going to wire the diagonal side branch with a BMW wire, and then we're going to do some ballooning to that very tight lesion, and then we're going to perform an IVUS in that diagonal side branch itself.
That should be good.
Yeah.
So now that we have a second wire down, does that confuse the co-registration at all or not?
I think providing we give it a clear path for it to follow, it shouldn't. But you see on the screen, the co-registration screen now, you see there's a static image coming up, which is actually the two markers of the balloon. And when you inject a little bit of contrast, you see that will come up and it will stabilize the image. Oh. And there you can see, I think you're right on it.
I think we're there, right?
Yeah, you're right on it.
Okay. So we're ready to do a little inflation?
Sure.
So that's 2, 4.
Yep, there's the waist.
And here's 6.
Brilliant.
I'm still late, Andy. Okay.
We'll do that.
Still, a little bit of a waist. And so we'll go up a little bit higher.
There we go.
Wow, so we actually saw it on the co-registration screen very easily.
So David, I saw your eyes flicking across to the static image, and it's quite appealing because it's bigger and easier to visualize.
So let's take an angio. Okay. Okay, as one might expect, there's a little sort of possible dissection at the spot where the lesion was.
Yeah. There's the ever so small, slightest side branch there, too, or a little branch coming off there that we saw on our initial images, too. But shall we go with IVUS next?
Yeah.
So I've advanced the IVUS now past the lesion.
So we're ready to record then.
Okay, so David, you're in a good location there. We can hit record, and then we can start the pullbacks.
All right.
So recording?
I'll begin the pullback.
Okay, yeah, go for it.
Probably a 2.5 millimeter vessel.
Very heavily diseased.
Quite.
So here's the interesting part. We come up to the ostium. It's really a 2 millimeter vessel there. And there is the ostium. And I think it's 2 millimeters at the ostium, but heavily diseased. So the flyby, as you were saying, didn't quite show us as much detail as this. And it is diseased right up to the ostium.
Okay, just hit stop, Rush.
I'll start with the pullback.
So,
that was helpful.
Mm.
So once again, you can see we can flick the angiogram position and get the relative IVUS location, and you can see that obviously the vessel is very diseased throughout its course, and I'm not sure what reference diameter you take.
Two and a half.
And we can use this to then give us an estimated length coming all the way back, and perhaps it's a little bit further.
Yeah. So if we took an 18 stent and put it close to the ostium, then I suppose that'd be a way. Personally, I'd probably take a 225 because that could always crank up to a 25, and I'm really worried that this is quite a small vessel even distally. So, so what do you think about a 225, maybe 18?
Yeah.
And see what that looks like, and hope for the best for the distal vessel.
And then what I'd like to do is also have a balloon in the LAD just as our backstop here too, And so what we can do is take a 3020 balloon. Does that sound good for you? Mm-hmm. And the LED? Our stent for the side branch. And this is a 20 millimeter stent, I believe, right?
Yeah, 2.25 by 20, yeah.
We're, let me tighten down our TUI here. So I could advance in a little bit, yeah, if you all agree. Try that there.
So that looks good in that view. Should we take a picture of that?
Sure.
It does look very good. Shall we take a spider as well?
Image stabilization there perhaps helps us.
That's really nice.
I mean, I would say that on that view, it looks in the ideal position.
It does.
But let's see what the spider shows us.
We'll just scoot the table down, please.
Yeah.
So unlock the table.
Unlock the table, please.
He hasn't quite got into position yet.
Okay.
Oh, that should be a good shot. Okay, yeah, so let's take a picture there.
All set?
Yeah.
Looks pretty good, that to me.
Okay, so I'd say that was pretty on ideal. Do you think, or do you want to pull it back another notch?
I might just pull it back one marker.
Okay.
If such precision exists.
Yes.
How about that?
Okay, let's take a picture. Okay,
that's great.
I think I quite like it.
Is it possible just to see the SyncVision screen? There we go. That's fantastic. So you can see the stabilizer image. That looks, it looks great. So happy to go there.
Perfect. Yes.
And that's the stent.
Okay. That's the stent. So what order do you want to do those in, David? Do you want to stent up first?
Let's go stent up first.
Okay. So we'll go on up. Okay.
And this is a 225.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, that's up. It's up to 10-12.
Justin, do you want to?
Yeah. I'm going up. Up to the same kind of pressure as 10-12 again?
Yeah, 10 should be fine.
10. Okay, there we go.
And we'll fluoro save that.
Okay, and okay. Ready, 1, 2, 3 down. Good.
There we go.
So you're giving that pressure wire a real workout here.
Yeah, we really are, Justin. We've placed it down. We've assessed the hemodynamics of four vessels. We've delivered IVUS over it. We've ballooned over it. We're going to stent over it as well. And I have to say, so far, it's holding up about the same as the BMW that went in. Now, in my approach, Justin, tell me what you and Urquhart would do in this case, too, is I'll withdraw the wire, rewire it, do another kiss, and then place the stent. The idea oftentimes in bifurcation disease, as you know, is we want to enter with the wire more distally. And here, actually, we can enter proximally just to reopen the coverage of the stent that is placed into the side branch. So we're post-dilating a bit into the stent into the side branch, and then we'll come back and treat it in a kissing fashion. But my eyes immediately go over to our sync screen, where you can see with greater clarity the end of the stent and the balloon markers as well.
It's very clear, isn't it, that
it really is.
The stent's pretty well opposed. I might crank it up a little bit further, because it does look like there's a small bite out of it. He's getting some pain now. But we're definitely within stent, so I think I'll come down.
Now I'll come back intentionally into the main vessel again. I probably have slid back on the 2.5 too much. How about that?
Well, uh-huh.
Okay. So David, you've I think used the Synergy stent in a clinical trial in the US. But it's not yet commercially available, is that right?
That's right. We've completed in the United States the Evolve trial with this particular stent. Thin strut cobalt alloy stent, a very deliverable stent with strong scaffolding characteristics. But, of course, one of the unique aspects of this technology is that it's an everolimus eluting stent, but it has a bioresorbable polymer coating so that It will return, in theory, back to the phenotype of a bare metal stent after dissolution of drug and polymer. The this is I think kind of the intermediate step between fully bioabsorbable scaffolding and existing durable polymer drug-eluting stents. I think that it's probably still a much-needed technology, given that we know that they're not all lesions are suitable for bioabsorbable scaffolding so far. And it would take a lot of patients and a large number of years of follow-up to truly demonstrate potential differences in safety. But there's some signals already that we've seen from earlier programs with both the biosensors and the Biotronic program as well. This stent traversed fairly readily across the bifurcation. What I'm going to do is I thought we'd take a little look at where we are. We'll take a picture. I'm going to pull that wire out of the side branch just so we don't trap wire within two stents. So don't let me forget to do that. But let's take a little peek at where we are right now. Sounds perfect. Yeah, and I even pulled back a little bit
To make sure that we're not overlapping at the diagonal branch.
Yeah.
Is it worth going to the spider and judging what length of stent? Because we can leave ourselves a good...
I don't think it would hurt us at all. You know, this has been a case that from the outset we were contemplating the potential to treat three different vessels. And so far we've been able to do this with fairly little radiation exposure and with little contrast so far.
So we'll swing the camera over. I think it'll show us that we're clear of the bifurcation, and I think it may well show us what an approximate stent length might be for the second stent. Okay, we don't want to leave it too short, do we? We don't have any 1 millimeter stents available. Okay, let's take a picture.
Do me a favor, just take a little puff there first. Yeah, so it's not going to be much, is it? I'm actually, if anything, I'm going to
push in.
Advance our stent.
Yeah, I think that's probably the advantage of taking this view, just to make sure we don't leave ourselves with too little a gap. Right, let's take a picture.
All set?
Yeah.
Well, you might argue I could have advanced even further.
See, I think you've got room.
I can certainly go down.
You can go down a little bit.
I don't want to get into that where that septal branch is, though.
No, absolutely.
So let me just go in about 3-4 millimeters. How about that?
Okay, pretty good. That's looking good. Okay, I think that's looking good.
All right, let me also now remove the wire from the side branch. And then I think we can go up.
Okay, let's go up. That's 12.
Well,
and that's 14.
Will fluoro acquire that?
Okay. And if we can see the sync screen as well, that's great.
Yeah, the sync screen shows that the balloon's well inflated. Okay.
Now what I might do is I'll bring this balloon back just a little bit. We'll go a little bit higher just to optimize the proximal end of this as we recross into the side branch.
Can you do that in spider?
I think that should be okay.
Okay, good.
I didn't pull it too far back.
No.
Okay, that's 16. Just fluoro acquire that, please. That's great.
Perfect. And then I'll re-advance back. We'll do our kissing, high-pressure sequential kissing inflation, and then move on to the proximal. I might be able to just get this with the torquer alone here. I hope.
I suppose a slight nervousness.
I got it.
No, well done. I suppose a slight nervousness is whether you might sort of catch a stent strut in the LAD, and then sort of still be able to get into the diagonal, but sort of around the side of the stent. If you see what I mean.
I do. In this case, again, I think this is seems to be one of the advantages, anecdotally, of this approach is that the guide wire typically will.
That's the
we'll advance into the side branch a little bit more easily now that we've done one extra step here of reconstructing that that carina. So let's go back with our kissing balloon inflations, but this time why don't we go back with a, do you want to use a 3-2-5 non-compliant balloon for the LAD?
Okay, so if we've got a 3-2-5 non-compliant, we do by 22, that'll do. Okay.
That'll be lovely, and then okay. I think...
3-2-5 times 22.
Yeah, so I think we're ready to go up now. So I tell you what, you have the, I have the diagonal, let me go up on the diagonal. And I'm going to go to 16.
Okay.
We'll floor. And down. And then, Justin, you'll do the LAD.
Okay. I'm going up. It's 20 there.
We'll floor. Thank you, Joe.
And down.
And then we'll do it together. I'm just going to pull back that a little, ever so slightly. Yeah.
And simultaneously?
Yes.
Yeah. So this approach really ensures that you've got good preparation and then good expansion.
It really does,
thereafter.
Yeah. And then what do you think, Justin? A 4-0 short stent for the very front?
4-0-8. Do you think 4-0-8?
4-0-8 should be good.
We've got a 4-0-8. Thanks. Going to move ahead and stent the proximal segment of the vessel with this 4x8mm synergy stent.
Yeah, and I think what we'll do at this point, Justin, is go to the LAO caudal view. That seemed to align in the best view of the ostium with the prior stent.
Good spider view. Thanks, Julius. And if so, for now, it would be very helpful to have the SyncVision if you've got that. That's super. Thank you.
So it looks like I could go in a bit here.
Yeah, you can, yeah.
How does that look there, Justin? Somewhere in between,
we're about
right?
A minute and a half into the stent, I think.
Yeah.
That's pretty good. Do you want to take a bit?
Yeah. Give me maybe a couple beats before. Am I into the stent?
I think you're just okay. Oh, yeah. We'll see you now. Are you just? I think you're just short, actually.
Yep.
You are.
I think we need a 12.
So this is a great illustration here of the of being absolutely certain that we're not overlapping.
It's a convincing image, and I don't think we're at the origin like we want to be, and I don't think we're certainly not into the stent. So we'll go back with a 4-0-12.
Okay.
Thanks. So this. I think this view is illustrative, too, of a common phenomenon in bifurcation disease, that you've got this lucency in the origin of the side branch. And this is really not, we used to think it's plaque shift, and it's really carinal deformation, or making it more of an elliptical shape to the origin of the side branch rather than a true circular shape. But we know by IVUS it looks just fine.
Yes, if you don't IVUS, it's a common misconception that something's going wrong with the vessel, isn't it?
Yeah, that you have to go back and do more work on it. All right. So do we come back some?
Yeah.
Let's see, Justin, how does that look?
Yeah, can we just cone in a bit, Julius, on there, just so we... That's better, yeah. And on the sides as well? That's super. Thank you. Okay.
Want to take a picture?
Yeah, let's take a picture of that.
Okay, I can clearly move in, and I did. I think we're going to need all of 12.
I think we will as well. So you ended up...
I ended up... why don't we take one more picture here? I ended up scooting in under Cine.
Okay. Okay, there you go, David.
Yeah. I think we're really at our tolerances for being in the stent. Do you agree? We're really right at the edge. It'd be nice maybe to think about, I think we're gonna land this right at the origin. What do you think?
I think you're in pretty good shape there.
Half a marker back, perhaps, but I don't want to miss put a gap too between the stents. Want to take this there? I did a little bit of a pinch on it to pull it back just a hair. We'll go up there.
Okay.
Actually, and on that last image, Justin, you could see that I had moved it back just a marker or so.
So fluorocarpus core pistules. Thank you. Thank you.
That's at 12 and down.
So you're going to... Will you push that balloon on and you'll do the junction?
It's going to do the overlap here, just like so. And I'm mindful to keep it proximal to the side branch. Perfect.
Okay.
Terrific. So no compromise to the circumflex. Looks like we've expanded the origin well. I think we went to reasonably good expansion on the front end of this. What do you think about IVUS now?
I think we should IVUS.
Yeah.
It's mandated by the protocol, but also in these proximal osteo LED lesions, I would always do
it. It's the proximal LED, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So we had reference distal vessels of 3.3 millimeters, I think. And proximal of around about 4.
Yeah. So. All set for a pullback?
Yeah.
All right. Here we go. So still moderate amount of plaque there in the mid-distal LED, but no edge dissection. Stent here is definitely well expanded and opposed. We have that all throughout, and it's fairly consistent. I think what we would expect too, that we didn't see a lot of heavy calcification here, just a lot of soft plaque with some scattered heterogeneous calcification on the initial images, just to come out to the more proximal segment of the LAD. And I jumped and back into the left main. We can stop there. Justin, do you want me to go on live and just advance down and make sure we got the origin covered?
Okay, that's a good idea.
A little bit of a jump. Yep. So thank you, Rasha. Yeah. So right here, here's our distal left main. You can see our circumflex from, 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock. And we've got maybe half a crown sticking out proximally and then fully covered at the origin. And I think here, that was just my thought that maybe we could be slightly greater expanded.
So what do you want to
I think we could go back with a 4-0, but just go to high pressure, if you agree.
Yeah. But a 4x20, 4x16, whatever.
So Justin, in this case, we've deployed the stent, we did IVUS, but we need to achieve some dimensions, pre-specified protocol dimensions for optimal stent expansion, and I don't think we quite had that on the proximal end. Is that right?
That's right. So we used the music guidelines in Syntex 2, and so we just need to push this proximal stent up a little bit more to creep over the magic kind of threshold for the guidelines for the study. So I think we're at around 8 millimeters, and we need to push it up to about 10 millimeters squared to...
right on the proximal end?
Yeah.
So what I'll do is I'll come on Cine here. It looks like we're right there. I'm pulling back just ever so slightly. I definitely don't want to come back into the left main. So
ready to go there?
Yeah.
Okay, going up. So this is the 4-0.
This is a 4016.
Absolutely right.
15. And I think this is good size for us too, because we're
Still actually expanding it.
We're just proximal to the bifurcation, and I think we look good there by IVUS. We just need to expand the proximal. Thank you, Julius.
Okay. Come on down.
Yes.
There we go.
And I'm just careful with an osteo lesion like that not to pull the guide in too much and have distortion of the stent, compression of the stent. And so, Justin, what I'll do is I'll take a picture just with the guide wire in of our hopefully near final result.
That's great.
I think it is noticeably more expanded even by angiography, too. And we'll do with the wire out this view and the aorto-cranial.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So David, there's our wire out shot. So we went up with a 4x15 non-compliant balloon in the proximal segment just to really ensure that proximal part was stretched. And are you happy with that result?
I am, Justin. I think that we've not only ensured that this was an adequate result by the angiography, but when we realized, even though it looked good proximally, the IVUS told us that we still had a little bit more work to do, and you went back at high pressure, and then we've confirmed it. And so this is, I think it's a terrific result. I think I have to go back and saying again, I'm most amazed that we took a case that angiographically seemed like a clear-cut three-vessel case to me, and we've converted it into even albeit still a complex bifurcation case, but a single vessel disease case, and did it with optimizing the best techniques too, with imaging and hemodynamic assessment. I'm glad we did it into the diagonal too. I think both territories look terrific.
I'd like to thank David for his expert guidance in this case, and I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks, David. Good man.
Thanks you, Justin. Much. That was terrific. Thank you, everybody.